So this is 83rd QSTM Zoominar talk. Today our speaker is Professor Bidusar Sahu from School of Physics, IZAT Trivandrum. And he's going to speak about superconformal approach to supergravity, which is in which he's working on from long time, his expertise area in supergravity. And thank you, Bidusar, for accepting this invitation to give this talk for QSTM forum, and we all are welcoming you in the forum to give the talk. So you can start.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Sayantan, for the invitation to give the talk. Okay. So it's you told me the time is rather very flexible. It's 2.5 hours, if I remember. Yeah. Okay. I may not go for that long. You know. Yeah. I don't know about the participants, but I'm definitely going to be tired. Okay, so, but I will give you all the details, all the relevant details that is required for understanding this topic. Okay, so my talk is on superconformal approach to supergravity.
Oh, Bindu sir, can you talk a little bit loudly? Your microphone is a little bit low. Could you please increase the volume of your...
My microphone is low? I mean, is it... I am quite near my laptop, I think.
Okay, otherwise, if you can't able to do anything, it's just okay. Just speak a little bit loud, then it will be sufficient.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, sure. Okay, so let me begin. The plan of my talk is as follows. So I will start with the introduction and I will go on discussing conformal gravity as a gauge theory. So this would be like a precursor to my talk. Before introducing supergravity, I will just try to introduce conformal gravity as a gauge theory, and then we will see how to extend it to supergravity. And then we will learn a little bit about how to construct actions in conformal supergravity, and then and I will discuss some recent results and end with some future directions. Okay, so let us begin. We all know that the two most successful and path-breaking theories of the 20th century has been quantum mechanics and general relativity. Okay, so this changed our perception of physics completely. And much of our efforts since the later half of the 20th century until now has been to reconcile both the theories into a theory of quantum gravity. And which would be important if you want to understand, for example, the physics of black holes or early universe. And string theory is one of the most successful attempts in that direction. The low energy effective description of string theory is given by supergravity. So string theory has much more than supergravity. However, if you want to truncate yourself to the low energy sector of string theory, it is described by supergravity. What is supergravity? Supergravity is a supersymmetric extension of general relativity, where supersymmetry is realized as the gauge symmetry. And why it is important? Because due to lack of direct evidence, experimental evidence for string theory, one relies on some theoretical tests to
since you said that supergravity is the supersymmetric extension of GR, so supergravity is classical. It is not a quantum theory.
Right.
Or semi-gravity. Or semi.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, supergravity. Yeah. I mean, it's classical in that sense. Yeah. It's a classical theory. You have to quantize supergravity. So you can look at perturbative quantization of supergravity, and supergravity is classical, right?
So
why supergravity is important? Of course, it's a sector of string theory. It's not the full string theory. And since string theory lacks direct experimental evidence, so one relies on some theoretical tests to verify the mathematical consistency of string theory as a theory of quantum gravity. Okay, And what are these theoretical tests? So one of the theoretical tests is to compare the microscopic entropy of a certain classes of black holes to the macroscopic entropy. And what is this microscopic entropy? Okay, so any thermodynamical object which has entropy has some number of microstates, and you just count the number of microstates and take its log. That gives you the microscopic entropy. So in the case of black holes, which also has entropy, any theory of quantum gravity should be able to give you the microstates whose counting should give you the entropy. And string theory being one of the attempts for the theory of quantum gravity gives you objects which you can use to construct microstates of black holes, and by counting these microstates, you can get the microscopic entropy of these black holes. And whereas the macroscopic entropy is calculated from a theory of gravity, in this case supergravity, okay, and it may or may not have higher derivative corrections. So typically, it has higher derivative corrections, and so the macroscopic entropy is calculated using Wall's formula, or in the case of extremal black holes, you can use the entropy function formalism by SEM. And you have to basically match these two things, which is like a consistency check for your underlying microscopic theory, which is string theory. And in order to find the exact quantum entropy of these black holes from supergravity, using this quantum entropy function formalism of SEM, it is important to have an off-shell formulation of supergravity. Okay, so there are some techniques that one can use to find this exact quantum entropy of these black holes using quantum entropy function formalism. And these techniques are called localization technique. I'm not going into details of the localization technique, but to apply these techniques, you need off-shell formulation of supergravity. So what is off-shell formulation of supergravity? So off-shell formulation means the supersymmetry acts on the fields in such a way that the supersymmetry algebra closes without using any equations of motion. That is when you say that the supersymmetries are realized off-shell. And it is important for this off-shell formulation so that you can apply localization technique and compute exact quantum entropy of these black holes using quantum entropy function formalism. And there have been various work in this direction by various people like Davulkar, Samir Murthy, etc. So I'm not going into all the details, but I'm just trying to motivate you why off-shell formulation of supergravity is important. And off-shell construction of supergravity is facilitated by what is the topic of my talk is the superconformal approach. Okay. So typically, off-shell construction of supergravity is a very tedious thing, and the superconformal approach basically facilitates this off-shell construction of supergravity. Okay, and in this talk, we will discuss this approach in detail. So that is the aim of this talk, to basically give you a flavor of this superconformal approach and how to construct off-shell supergravity theories using the superconformal approach. Okay, I guess. I have given you enough motivation, so let us start discussing first this theory.
In a very simple word, what do you mean by this superconformal approach? Is it kind of some superconformal field theoretic extension of the supergravity or something like that?
No. So what we really want is supergravity, which is just a supersymmetric extension of gravity. Okay, and we want an off-shell formulation of that. But that is quite tedious. So what we do is basically we construct a theory of gravity which has more symmetries. Okay, which has more symmetries. I mean, it has more other than supersymmetry. It has actually superconformal symmetries. Okay, so a theory of gravity with superconformal symmetries is what we call a superconformal gravity. Okay, so that is easier to construct in the off-shell in an off-shell way, which is what we are going to discuss. Okay, and then we will discuss also how to come down from superconformal gravity to the physical supergravity, which doesn't have these extra symmetries.
So when this observation was made regarding the fact that this is very simple, like, is it very new or it's basically older observation?
This is like the work from the 80s where this supernormal approach was introduced to construct these theories. Okay, so yeah, so let us begin. Let us try to understand first conformal gravity as a gauge theory. Okay, so so I hope most of you here know about gauge theories. So basically, let us start writing down a gauge theory based on the conformal algebra. Okay. So what is the conformal algebra? So conformal algebra basically are constructed out of the generators. Which are basically your so we have this this is your translation generator, this is a Lorentz transformation generator, and so these are the generators of Poincare algebra, right? Poincare algebra has translation and Lorentz transformation. So in conformal algebra, other than the translation and Lorentz transformation, you also have special conformal transformation generators and dilatation generators. Okay, and together they form an algebra, which is your conformal algebra. So this is your conformal algebra. Okay. And just like we do for any non-abelian gauge theory, so we will basically write down a non-abelian gauge theory for this conformal algebra. So for every generator, you will have a gauge field and a corresponding field strength. So so for the translation generator, we introduce this gauge field E mu A. For Lorentz transmission generator, we introduce this gauge field omega mu A B. For special conformal transmission generators, we introduce this gauge field F mu A. And for dilatation, we introduce this gauge field B mu. Okay, and there are corresponding field strength also. So for every gauge field, you have a field strength. So this has a field strength which I call Rp mu nu A. So this bracket P basically means corresponding to what generator it is. And for omega mu AB, I have R mu Rm mu nu AB. So this M is basically means that it corresponds to this generator M, and so on. For F mu A, you have Rk mu nu A. For B mu, you have Rg mu.
Sir, what is R here?
R is the field strength. So I am denoting the field strength by R. Okay. So because it will be also, you will see it is also the curvature. Basically, when we make it into theory of gravity, it basically becomes becomes curvature. So that is why I am using the letter R here instead of F. Usually we use the letter F to denote the field strength, but here I am using the letter R because eventually it will become some sort of curvature. Okay.
Okay.
Right. So yeah. So these are the gauge fields and the field strength. Now, so far it was a gauge theory. So you have some non-abelian algebra, Lie algebra, and you have constructed a gauge theory based on that Lie algebra. But what we want is a theory of gravity. So in order to convert this gauge theory into a theory of gravity, we need two things. Okay. We need So we need that instead of so in a theory of gravity, you don't have any translation symmetry. Instead, you have a diffeomorphism symmetry, right? So in a theory of gravity, you have diffeomorphism and you have local Lorentz transformation symmetry also. Okay. So here we have to convert this translation into diffeomorphism, and all the other symmetries would be realized as symmetries on the transient space. Like MAB will be realized as a local Lorentz transformation, and K would be realized as a local spatial conformal transformation, and D would be realized as local dilatation. Okay, but PA should be that local translation should be somehow converted to diffeomorphism. Okay, and that is where how you will convert this gauge theory into a theory of gravity. Okay, so in order to do this, we need to impose these constraints on the field strength that we had introduced, which I will henceforth call as curvature. Okay, so we need to impose constraints on the curvature so that these things are achieved. Okay, and some of the constraints are this. So you need these two constraints, okay, on this curvature, which will make this gauge theory the theory of gravity. Okay. So I can roughly tell you how we arrive at this constraint. So if you look at this constraint, okay, so I need to give you the form of Rp mu nu, but that given the structure constants, given the structure constants here of this algebra and standard rules of non-abelian gauge theory. You can write down this curvature rp mu nu, okay, and you will realize that this constraint rp mu nu a is equal to zero is nothing but your first Kappa structure equation, okay, which basically relates the spin connection to e mu a. Okay, so if you impose this constraint, your omega mu a b, which was so far a gauge field corresponding to m a b, and e mu a, which was so far a gauge field corresponding to p a, would basically be the Wheelbine and the spin connection. Okay, and this would be like the first Kappa structure equation. Okay, and this constraint is the conformal analog of Kappa structure equation, which will tell you that the gauge field corresponding to special conformal transmission, which was this f mu a, will also become dependent. Okay, so if it was just a theory of gravity, you would only need the Kappa structure equation, but since it's a theory of conformal gravity, you need something more, and this is that something more. Okay. Okay, so this imposing these two constraints on this curvature essentially converts the gauge theory into a theory of gravity. Okay, the local translation is converted into a diffeomorphism, and every other symmetry is realized on the tangent space. Okay, so your omega mu a b and f mu a, they basically become dependent, which is what you want in a theory of gravity. Okay, and their dependency on the other fields is given by this constraint equations. Okay.
So basically, I mean, previously your omega and the your frame fields had a local Lorentz symmetry. So should now they have a local conformal symmetry in this formalism?
You have, as I said, you have local Lorentz symmetry. You have local, and you also have special conformal transmission and dilatation. All these are local symmetries, right?
Right.
All these symmetries are acting on the tangent space. Yes.
Well, I'm saying that your spin connection and your frame leads, they individually had, I mean, once the tangent one rule, they individually had local Lorentz symmetry in the, at least in bosonic gravity. So would that symmetry be enlarged to include conformal symmetry?
Correct. So omega mu a, for example, would transform under special conformal transmission to f mu a, yeah, to b mu, yeah. So there is a special transformation of omega mu a b. There is a special conformal transmission of omega f mu a. There is a dilatation transformation of not omega mu a b, but e mu a will transform under dilatation. It will have a wild weight, but omega mu a b would be not under that. I mean, it essentially has wild weight zero, so it doesn't transform under dilatation. Okay, but it will transform under special conformal transformation, for example. So all the symmetry would be acting on the fields. Some fields may not transform under some symmetry, but in general, all the fields would be transforming under all the other symmetries.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Right. So yeah, I'm not giving the details of how these fields transform under all the other symmetries. Okay, that would be too much, going into too much technical details. But yes, so basically. Yeah, so basically, yeah, now your symmetries are basically diffeomorphism, local Lorentz transformation, local dilatation, and local special conformal transformation. And all these symmetries act on the fields in some way. Okay, so now now we have a theory of gravity. After imposing these constraints, we have a theory of gravity. In fact, we have a theory of conformal gravity now. Okay, so this is how we constructed conformal gravity from gauge theory. Okay, so till this point, we have a theory of conformal gravity. Okay, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to count the number of degrees of freedom in conformal gravity. Okay, so if I just do a counting, so let us say look at the independent field. So to count the number of degrees of number of official degrees of freedom, I need to count the number of components in the independent gauge fields and then subtract the number of symmetries. That will give me the number of official degrees of freedom. And if you do that counting, it will come out to be 5. Okay. Okay, so it's easy to see. So you have E mu A, the independent fields are E mu A and B mu, right? Omega mu A B and F mu A have become dependent. Okay, so your independent fields are E mu A and B mu. Okay, so E mu A has 16 components. So I'm doing the counting in 4 dimensions. Okay, so E mu A has 16 components, 4 × 4. B mu has 4 components. Okay, that makes it total 20. And the symmetries are You have local Lorentz transformation, which is six. You have diffeomorphism, which is 4, 6 plus 4, 10. You have special conformal transformation, which is 4, 10 plus 4, 14, and you have dilatation, which is 15. Okay, so 20 minus 15 is 5. Okay, so you have the total number of optional degrees of freedom is 5 in conformal gravity. Okay, but in your physical gravity, which is what I will call as Poincaré gravity, where you don't have the extra dilatation and the special conformal transmission symmetries, and the only independent field in that theory is your metric, which is E mu A. Okay, so there the optional degrees of freedom is 6, right? So in that theory, your only independent field is E mu A, which will have 16 components, and you have local Lorentz transformation, which is 6, and diffeomorphism, which is 4. Okay, 6 plus 4 is 10, and 16 minus 10 is 6. So in Poincaré gravity, your total number of optional degrees of freedom is 6. Okay, whereas in conformal gravity, it is 5. Okay, so which means that if you want to come from conformal gravity to Poincaré gravity, you need one additional degree of freedom. Okay, and that additional degree of freedom comes from a scalar field, which is called a compensator scalar field. So this is called compensator because basically this will compensate for an extra symmetry. So you are adding a field which will compensate for an extra symmetry that you're going to remove from conformal gravity to come to Poincaré gravity. Therefore, this is called a compensator field. Okay, so this is, in this case, we are taking it to be a real scalar field. Okay, because the mismatch is only one degree of freedom, right? So you need one extra degree of freedom that will come from a real scalar field.
Sir, do we have to give that equations of motions or the dynamics of this field also?
Yes, indeed. And we are going to discuss that. Okay, that is going to come. Okay. So now I am going to tell you how to come from conformal gravity to Poincaré gravity. Okay. So what we will do is we'll start by writing down the conformally invariant action for the scalar field. Okay. So this is the conformally invariant action for the scalar field. So the scalar field has to transform under all the conformal symmetries that is there. Okay, so it is since it's a scalar field, it will not transform under Lorentz transformation. Okay, I also demand that it doesn't transform under special conformal transformation. It only transforms under dilatation. Okay, so it will only transform under dilatation. Okay, which means that it will have some weight. So dilatation is like a scaling symmetry. So it transforms under dilatation with some weight, and that weight is plus one. Okay, and we introduce this conformally invariant Lagrangian for the scalar field. Okay, this d mu is the conformally covariant derivative. Okay, and since these are conformally covariant derivatives, so by construction, this is conformally invariant. Okay, and I have taken it with the wrong sign. You can note because the right sign is del mu phi del mu phi. Okay, but if you just do an integration by part, it is minus del mu phi del mu phi. Okay. So the kinetic term has wrong sign, and that is important here. We will see. Okay. The Sellers scalar field transforms under dilatation. Hence, the covariant derivatives are defined like this. Okay. So scalar field transforms under dilatation with a weight plus one. So the covariant derivative is given like this. Okay. And the double covariant derivative. Now, this covariant derivative will transform under dilatation as well as special conformal transmission. Because the gauge field corresponding to dilatation transforms under special conformal transmission. As a result of which, in the double covariant derivative, you will also have a F mu A. Okay, right? So this double covariant derivative appears in your Lagrangian, which has omega mu AB and F mu A, which are our dependent gauge fields. And if you actually write down these dependent gauge fields in terms of E mu A and B mu, and put it into this double covariant derivative, you will find that the Lagrangian is basically this. Okay, where R is the Ricci scalar. Okay, so this will come from if you work out the details of how this F mu A depends on the independent fields. Okay, So you will see that this the dependency of F mu n independent fields, you can write it as a Ricci tensor and a Ricci scalar, and as a result of which this Ricci scalar will appear here. Okay. So if you work out the details, you will get this. Okay, I'm not going to tell and give you all the details, but if you just work out the details, you will get this. Okay. So this is what you will get.
Why this 1/6 term appear 1/6?
That is there in F mu A, right? So if the F mu, when you look at how F mu A depends on the other gauge fields, okay, and write it down. So you will write, you will see that F mu A, you can write as a combination of Ricci tensor and Ricci scalar. And since this is a these covariant derivatives indices are contracted, so everything will come in terms of Ricci scalar. And once you work it out, this 1/6 will come out.
Yeah. Okay.
So yeah, so this is the Lagrangian that you obtain from here after you have written down the dependent gauge fields in terms of the independent gauge fields. Okay. So still this is a conformally invariant Lagrangian, okay, because this was also a conformally invariant Lagrangian. Okay, so this is also a conformally invariant Lagrangian. Okay. Now you want to go from conformal gravity to Poincaré gravity. Okay.
Other people can able to hear anything?
No, sir.
No, it seems to be stuck.
Yes. Is there any student of him? Because I don't know the phone. Yes, he's here. So yeah, video was stuck. So could you please share it again? And
yeah, I think this my net got disconnected. Okay, I think it's visible now.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay, so yeah, so I was here. So yeah, so these are the gauge fixing condition. B mu is equal to zero will fix the special conformal transformation, and setting phi to constant will fix the dilatation, right? Because phi transforms under dilatation by a non-trivial way. Okay, so setting phi to a constant will fix the dilatation, and this is just a convention to take the constant like this. And once you do that, the Lagrangian that you had basically boils down to the Einstein-Hilbert action. Okay. So you see how we could get the Einstein gravity from conformal gravity by this approach. Okay. Yeah. So this is of course. Yes.
Upon gauge fixing, we will get any like quantum two, you would expect some ghost fields. You don't get any ghost fields here.
Yeah, I mean, I'm doing classical. Yeah, you're right. Like if you're doing gauge fixing, you will perhaps get some ghost fields and all these things. I'm not sure that this gauge fixing, like it's not always that you will get a ghost field. Like all gauge fixing conditions don't give a ghost field. Like no. Like for example, in electrodynamics, if you use a Lorentz gauge fixing condition, you don't get any ghost field, right? So it's not. I'm not sure.
You're saying that here.
Yes.
So you're saying that here. I mean, you don't expect a ghost field to appear in any particular formalism.
Yeah, I think so because. See these gauge fixing conditions actually, these are you know algebraic gauge fixing condition. I mean, I think the ghost field will like decouple. Like I'm not sure, but I think they will not appear. But yeah, I'm not sure.
I had one question. So here you actually transform conformal gravity to the Einstein gravity, but can that be done by doing some kind of transformation in the metric as well, because there is some kind of formalism which transforms one frame to another frame like that. If you transform the metric with some conformal factor appearing in the metric, rescaling.
No, we are not doing any sort of wild rescaling. No, I think you are saying wild rescaling. Like if you rescale the metric. By some wild rescaling, you will get some kinetic term for the scalar field and all. So here we are not doing wild rescaling.
So
we are not going from Einstein frame to string frame or whatever. Right? Yeah, in principle, if you do a wild rescaling here, you will get some extra factors corresponding to the scale. That's precisely because this action has lost scale invariance. Okay. Right, this doesn't have scaling symmetry. Whereas your conformal gravity had scaling symmetry. So that is exactly so here. So when we wrote down this action, this was conformally invariant. So if you do a wild rescaling of if you scale the metric and the scalar field simultaneously, okay, the scale factor will go away. Yeah, that's precisely because this is scale invariant. Okay, but once you have fixed the scale symmetry by imposing this gauge fixing condition, then your Lagrangian doesn't have any scaling symmetry, right? So if you do a wild rescaling, then of course you will it's not invariant. You will get some new action, right? Yeah. Okay, so this was, we obtained the Einstein-Hilbert action by starting from a conformally invariant action for a scalar field, okay, which was our compensating scalar field, okay. You could also write down a conformally invariant action made purely out of the gravity sector fields, okay. So for example, if you have this Lagrangian, so where this Rm is the curvature for your local Lorentz transformation, so by construction, this Lagrangian is also conformally invariant, okay? Because these are curvatures and you are just contracting the curvature, okay? Just like F mu is gauge invariant, so R mu AB is also conformally invariant, okay? So this Lagrangian is also conformally invariant by construction, and once we impose these gauge fixing conditions on this Lagrangian, so this Rm will in general contain B mu, it will contain F mu A and all these things. So once you impose this gauge fixing condition on this on Rm, it becomes a wild tensor. Okay, so this Lagrangian, upon using this gauge fixing condition, will become wild square. So if you start from a conformally invariant action of the scalar field and the gravity sector fields and do the Poincaré gauge fixing, you will basically obtain Einstein-Hilbert action plus wild square correction. Okay, That's okay. You will not in this setup. You would not obtain arbitrary higher derivative correction. You will only obtain wild square kind of corrections to Einstein gravity. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So this is all that I want to say you about how to deal with conformal gravity as a gauge theory and how to obtain Poincaré gravity from conformal gravity. Okay. And most of the things that I have discussed here, we will be basically generalizing it to supersymmetric case from the next section. So I can ask more questions if you have now. Yeah.
Sir, can you go back to the place where you first defined the covariant derivative for the compressor?
Okay. Yeah.
Here, can you explain again why the covariant derivative is defined only in terms of the limitation?
Because phi, so there are, what are the gauge symmetries? So the gauge symmetries are local Lorentz transformation, special conformal transformation, dilatation. Okay,
yes.
These are our symmetries, right? Okay.
Yes, sir.
And phi, yes. You're saying something?
No, sir, continue.
Yeah, so phi doesn't transform under local Lorentz transformation and special conformal transformation. It only transforms under dilatation. Okay.
So okay, that is
only dilatation gauge fields appear. Gauge field appears.
So you want that the Lagrangian should be invariant under the derivation transformation, right? So that's why.
Covariant derivative. Let me. So generally, covariant derivative would be like this, right?
Yes, correct.
Okay. So where B mu A is the gauge field and T A is the generator. Okay. So now so there is a summation over A, right? Okay,
yes,
so this generator TA has basic, if you sum over A, so the generator TA can be MAB, it can be KA, and it can be D, right? Okay, so
yes.
MAB and MAB acting on phi is zero, and KA acting on phi is zero, okay, because phi doesn't transform under dilatation and local Lorentz transformation. It only transforms under, it doesn't transform under special conformal transmission or local Lorentz transmission. It only transforms under dilatation. Okay, right?
Yes,
so
sir.
D phi is equal to phi. Okay, so and
for the double covariant derivative, that also can explain.
For the double covariant derivative, now D, you have to see, for writing down the double covariant derivative, you have to see how dA phi transforms. Okay, I have converted this mu to A, okay, to local Lorentz index using the VL bind. Okay, so now dA phi transforms under local Lorentz transformation because it has a local Lorentz index A. Okay, it transforms under dilatation. Okay, okay, so it has the same wild weight as phi, so it transforms under dilatation. And because BA transforms under special conformal transmission, I have not given you all the details, but BA transforms under special conformal transmission, as a result of which dA also transforms under special conformal transformation.
Okay.
So that is why all the gauge fields appear, B mu, omega mu A, B as well as F mu A. Okay, in the double covariant derivative. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other question?
So sir, that's why from going from conformal gravity to Poincaré gravity, we only need to fix the beam phi. Because phi only fix the beam mu and phi, right? That's
right.
Why you chose.
Yeah. Right, right.
Because it only depends on the transformation of phi.
So we have to gauge fix special conformal transmission and dilatation. These are the only two symmetries we have to fix. In order to come from conformal gravity to Poincaré gravity, right? These are the only two symmetries we need to fix. Okay, the field that transforms under special conformal transmission is B mu. So to fix special conformal transmission, we use this condition B mu is equal to zero. Okay, and to fix dilatation, we fix phi to a constant. Okay. In this way, the special conformal transmission and dilatations are completely fixed.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Okay. Okay, so now let us move to conformal supergravity. Okay. So again, you have to start with the gauge theory corresponding to the super conformal algebra. So earlier we had conformal algebra, now we will consider super conformal algebra. And then you impose curvature constraints to convert the gauge theory into a theory of gravity. Okay. And there is an additional thing that you need to do here is you may need to complete the field representation by adding some auxiliary fields and modifying the super conformal transformation. Okay. The addition of auxiliary fields we will see would be required if you want to match the bosonic degrees of freedom and Fermi degrees of freedom. You know that in a theory of supersymmetry, the bosonic degrees of freedom and Fermi degrees of freedom has to match. Okay. So we will see that addition of these auxiliary fields is important to match the bosonic degrees of freedom and Fermi degrees of freedom. And once you add these auxiliary fields to your set of fields, which will form a multiplet, you will also have to modify the super conformal transformation, okay, in such a way that the super conformal algebra is also modified, okay, where the structure constants will be generalized. Instead of being constants, they will become functions, okay. So somebody I don't know who is doing this. Anybody? I mean, I don't know. I am not doing this yellow lines. I don't know who is doing this. Okay. So whoever is doing this, can you erase it? I mean, or I have to erase it. I have not done this. Yeah. Yeah. I'm seeing this for the first time that somebody else can actually put some lines on the screen.
Can you remove it, sir, or you can't?
I don't know. Let me check. Because it's not in my screen, so I don't know how to remove it. Yeah, if it was in my screen, I could have removed it, but.
Yeah, you just.
Okay, I mean, this is
not at all a problem. You just cross it.
Yeah. Okay, but I don't know if it's something like this is doable. Please don't do it. Okay, I think next slide onwards it will be okay. And this is fine here. Okay, so you have to modify the super conformal transformation, and at the same time the super conformal algebra would change. Like the super conformal algebra would in the study you started with here. Had structure constants, but once you do this, okay, you will end up with a super conformal algebra where instead of structure constants, you have structure functions. That means field-dependent structure constants. Okay, such an algebra would be known as a soft algebra. It's known in the literature as soft algebra. Okay, so once you end up doing this procedure, instead of having earlier superconformal algebra, you will end up with a soft superconformal algebra. But it's where the structure constants are modified into structure functions. Okay, and the fields and the gauge fields together with these additional auxiliary fields that you have added would basically transform onto each other under the superconformal transformation. And this will form a multiplet, which is known as the Weyl multiplet. Okay.
Sir, I have this basic question is you have a conformal algebra first. So super conformal algebra means you have super symmetry and the angles. Can you explain what is SU2?
Okay, I'm going to explain that. Okay, I'm going to explain that. Okay, so I'm so if you hold on for a moment, if you still don't get answer to your question, you can ask me again. Okay,
okay, sir.
Okay, so let me tell you what this algebra is. So I will just give you the generators of this algebra. Okay, I will not give you the full algebra, by which I mean that to give the commutation and anti-commutation relation. Okay, that you can find in any reference, like if you want. Okay, so SU 2,2 is the conformal algebra. Basically, the conformal algebra that I had shown you earlier is SU 2,2. Okay, so Yeah. So the conformal algebra is SO2,4 or SU2,2. Okay. So that is the conformal algebra. And this /2 means, or /n means, okay, you are modifying it by adding n fermionic generators. In this case, you're modifying it by adding 2 fermionic generators. In 4 dimension, you're basically adding 2 Majorana spinners. These fermionic generators are Majorana spinners in 4 dimensions. So you're adding 2 Majorana spinners. Okay. Okay. So these are the generators. Okay. So this PA, MAB, KA, and D, these are the things that you have seen earlier in the conformal algebra. Okay. They form a SU2,2 algebra. Okay. Now, other than these generators, you also have QI, okay, where I runs from 1 to n. In this example, I'm giving I runs from 1 to 2. Okay. And these are Majorana spinners. So these are fermionic generators and they are Majorana spinners for each I. Okay. And since it's a super conformal algebra, so you have a fermionic analog of special conformal transformation. Just like QI is a fermionic analog, a fermionic partner of translation. So similarly, you have a fermionic partner for special conformal transformation, which is labeled as SI. So this is like a special supersymmetry. Okay. Yeah. Here also I runs from 1 to 2. Okay. So here it's like you have 4 supersymmetry generators. Okay. But the additional 2 are because it's a super conformal algebra. Okay. Okay. That is not reflected here. Here you still write 2. Okay. Because the 2 supersymmetry generators are actually your original supersymmetry generators. The extra 2 supersymmetry generators, which are called special supersymmetry, arises because it's a conformal, super conformal algebra. Okay, so these are your fermionic generators. Okay, and you also have 2 additional bosonic symmetries which you did not have in conformal algebra. That is basically because you have these fermionic generators and you can rotate them onto each other. So there are 2 fermionic generators, and you can have a symmetry which can rotate these fermionic generators on to each other, and that is called an R symmetry. Okay, so you have a SU2R symmetry because of that, and you can also change it by a phase. Okay, so there is a U1R symmetry also. Okay, so for SU2, so these are the generators of SU2,2/2, the conformal algebra generators, the supersymmetry generators, and the R symmetry generators. Okay, right? Does it answer your question, Abhinav, about this algebra?
Yes, sir. Can you explain a bit the rotations you were saying from fermionic generators, bosonic generators?
Yeah. So there are these 2 fermionic generators. So you can have an outer automorphism of these 2 fermionic generators, which is basically the R symmetry. Okay. Right. So yeah. I mean that much I can tell you right now. I mean we can talk about the details later, but. In the case of supersymmetry, you can if it was n equal to 1, for example, if it was SU2,2/1, if there was only 1 Q and 1 S, there was no I here, they will not have SU2, but you will have a U1. Okay. You can change that Q by a phase. Okay.
So is it that for the extra fermionic generators we have SU2
yeah. Right. So here you have 2 fermionic generators, and because of that you have SU2R symmetry. Okay. You also have the U1, okay, but you have SU2R symmetry also. In case of n equal to 1, you would have only have U1. You will not have any SC. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. And then
For this to QI, SI, should I not expect SU2,2 R symmetry? I mean, was it breaking down to U1?
No. There is only 1 SU2 which rotates this QI and SI. Yeah. There are not 2 SU2s. Yeah.
No, but I'm just saying that you have basically your supersymmetry generators and your generators corresponding to the super partners of the conformal symmetry. So individually, you should be able to rotate them, right? So one should expect, I suppose, SU2,2, or does it for some reason break down to U1? That's my question.
No.
I mean the
yeah. So yeah, I see all. I mean, at the end of the day, you have to write down, the commutation relation and the Jacobi identity has to be satisfied. And from there, you can see what are the possible generators that you can have. right? So, okay. So yeah, so I'm not giving all the details, but it's not like it's SU2 cross SU2 which is breaking to E1. It's not like that. Yeah, so there is just one SU2 on one.
Okay.
Right? In fact, you will see that for n equal to 4, you don't have a E1. Okay. That's coming from the Jacobi identity and all these things has to be satisfied. So in n equal to 4, you will not have a U1 also. You will only have SU4. Okay?
Okay.
Yeah. Right. So these are the generators of my SU2, 2 slash 2. And like we did for conformal gravity, you have to introduce, like, you know, you're writing down the gauge theory for this algebra. So you have to have gauge fields for each of these generators and the corresponding field strength or curvatures. Okay. So it's a gauge theory. Now, in order to convert it into theory of gravity, okay, as we have discussed, we have to introduce some curvature constraints. Okay. And these are the curvature constraints that we already had for conformal gravity. Okay. This is an additional curvature constraint that you need to impose because it's a super conformal gravity. Okay. So this curvature constraint we had seen makes your field omega mu AB and F mu A dependent. And this curvature constraint is going to make your phi I dependent. Okay. Okay. So phi I is the gauge field for the special supersymmetry. Okay. So this. Yeah. So this was our phi mu I. Yeah, the gauge field of the special supersymmetry will also become dependent as a result of the curvature constraint that we had. Okay, right? So the dependent gauge fields are omega mu ab, f mu a, and phi mu I. Okay, now we also need to add some auxiliary field, and I will show you in a while why we need to add these auxiliary fields by doing some kind of counting to match the bosonic and fermionic degrees of freedom. Okay, so these are necessary to complete the multiplet so that the bosonic degree of freedom and fermionic degree of freedom matches. Okay, and together with the independent gauge fields, they constitute the Weyl multiplet for n equal to 2 conformal supergravity. So we were looking at n equal to 2 here, and so they form the Weyl multiplet for n equal to 2 conformal supergravity. Okay. And there are some cosmetic changes in the literature. If you look at the literature, you will see that for n equal to 2 supergravity, they are not actually imposing these constraints. Okay, they're imposing some modified constraints, okay, where they're modifying these constraints by some terms which are dependent on these auxiliary fields. That is basically, you know, amounting to saying that you are making some sort of field redefinition of these dependent gauge fields. Okay. The reason they are doing that is basically to simplify some supersymmetry transmission rules. Otherwise, it becomes very long and complicated. Okay. So that is some cosmetic change that you will find in the literature, where they change this constraint so that the supersymmetry transmission rules become somewhat simpler. Okay, and this you can find in this reference the n equal to 2 Weyl multiplet and their supersymmetry transmission rules and what modified curvature constraints they have imposed. Okay. Yeah. So similarly for n equal to 4 also in the same reference, they have worked out the n equal to 4 Weyl multiplet. Okay. So these are the gauge fields of the n equal to 4 Weyl multiplet. Okay. E mu A, psi mu Y, B mu 1, B mu Y J. So this is the VL bind. This is the gravitino. This is the dilatation gauge field. And this is the gauge field for SU4. Note that we don't have any gauge field for U1 here. Because as I said sometimes earlier, for n equal to 4 superconformal algebra, you don't have a U1 R symmetry. So there is no gauge field for U1. So there is only SU4 gauge field. Okay. And these are the additional fields that you need to add to your to this set of gauge fields to match the bosonic and fermionic degrees of freedom. Okay, but unlike SU2, not all these gauge fields are auxiliary. Not all these fields are auxiliary. Okay. In particular, these fields, the scalar, I will explain what is these fields. So this will be, this is a doublet of Majorana spinner. So this will be like a dilatino. And this is basically, a complex scalar. Okay, doesn't look like a complex scalar, but this is basically a complex scalar which will be the dilaton axial field. Okay. So let me tell, this field is very important. So I will tell you a little bit about this field, and I will not tell you so much about these fields, but I will tell you a little bit about these fields. So here, this phi alpha, this alpha level runs from 1 to 2, and phi 1 and phi 2 are basically complex scalar fields. Okay. And they satisfy this constraint. Okay. Phi alpha is equal to 0, where phi upper alpha is basically related to the conjugate of phi alpha in this particular way, where eta alpha beta, I have not written down here, but it is diagonal minus 1 plus 1. Okay. So that is what is phi alpha. And this constraint basically tells us that this phi alpha parameterizes a SC1,1 manifold. Okay. So there is
alpha is what index here means, number of fields or what?
Alpha is 1 to 2. Alpha is equal to 1,2. Okay. So there are, you have phi 1, phi 2. Okay. So there are two complex scalar fields. Okay. And they satisfy this constraint. Okay. So this constraint basically means you have phi 1, phi 1. Plus phi 2 is equal to 1. Okay. And if you use this definition, okay, you will see that phi 1 is equal to, I think in my notation it was plus 1 minus 1. Phi 1 is equal to phi 1 star, and phi 2 is equal to minus phi 2 star. Okay, so this constant is basically phi 1 star minus phi 2 star is equal to 1. Okay, so you have two complex scalar field satisfying this real condition. Okay, right? So basically, which means that you have three real scalar fields, okay, encoded in this phi alpha. Okay, and these three real scalar fields parameterizes the SC1,1 manifold. SC1,1 manifold is a three-dimensional manifold, and these three real scalar fields parameterizes a SC1,1 manifold. Okay. So you have three real scalar fields, all of them are not physical in this n equal to 4 supergravity. Okay, only two of them are physical, which parameterizes say SC1,1/U1 cosec. Okay. So that is a complex scalar field which is physical. Okay, not this phi alpha. And the reason why everything in n equal to 4 supergravity, in conformal supergravity, is written in terms of phi alpha, because SU1,1 acts linearly on phi alpha, whereas it will act non-linearly on tau. Okay. And since the transformation rule for n equal to 4 conformal supergravity are given in terms of SU1,1 invariant objects, okay. So if you want to write down everything in terms of tau, it becomes highly nonlinear and very complicated. Okay. To make it look simpler and linear, everything is written down in terms of phi alpha instead of tau. Okay. But once you keep in mind that phi alpha has three components and all of them are not physical, the physical complex scalar field belongs to this SC1,1 by U1 cosec. Okay. Where this E1 is realized as a gauge symmetry in this entire setup, but it does not have a independent gauge field. Okay. The E1 here has a gauge field which is a dependent one. So it doesn't appear here. So you don't see it here. Okay. Okay. So this is roughly that it's a long story, but this is roughly I can tell you in very brief. Okay. Right. Okay. So this is the structure of n equal to 4 while multiplier. Okay. And these fields, the complex scalar field and this doublet of Majorana-Spinner, these are physical dynamical fields, unlike these fields which will be auxiliary. In n equal to 2, all the additional fields that we added were all auxiliary. But in this case, not all fields are auxiliary. There are also dynamical fields. Okay.
Okay,
sir. Yes. Okay. So, So these were this n equal to 2 while multiplet and n equal to 4 while multiplet were constructed in the reference that I showed you in while discussing n equal to 2 by a paper by Bagshaw, DeWitt and Deru in 1981. Okay. But between n equal to 2 and n equal to 4, there is a n equal to 3, which no one looked into. Okay, I mean, n equal to 3 is very interesting because what you can show using the representation of supersymmetry algebra that if your highest spin of the representation is less than 2, okay, which means if it is 1, for example, if it is 1, then n equal to 3, all n equal to 3 representation, and if it is also CPT conjugate, all n equal to 3 representations become n equal to 4. Okay, so that is something that you can show. It's you can see it in any standard book of supersymmetry. So therefore, if you write down a CPT conjugate field theory for n equal to 3 supersymmetry, it always has a fourth supersymmetry. It is always n equal to 4. Okay, so there is no genuine CPT conjugate n equal to 3 supersymmetric field theory. Okay. But if you include gravity, that is not so. I mean, if you have n equal to 3 supergravity, then it is not n equal to 4. Okay. However, in earlier people never bothered to look at n equal to 3 supergravity in the super conformal setup, although there were alternative setup in which they were looking at. Okay. But I think first pioneered by Van Muyden and Van Foyn, and then due to work that I did with my former student Subramanya Hegde, we got to know about the n equal to 3 while multiplet. Okay, so n equal to 3 while multiplet, these are the gauge fields. Okay, these are the gauge fields. And these are the additional fields that you need to add to the multiplet to complete the multiplet, out of which this will be a physical field. So this will have some physical degree of freedom, right? It will be a dynamical field, and the remaining fields will be auxiliary. So that is an n equal to 3 while multiplet, which was recently found in 2019. Okay, so these are some examples of while multiplet. And now let me tell you why these extra fields are important. I will only do it for n equal to 2. I will do the counting for n equal to 2. Similar counting can be done for n equal to 3 and n equal to 4. Okay, so let us do the counting for n equal to 2 and motivate ourselves why these extra fields that I had introduced was important. Okay. So these are my gauge fields, E mu A, B mu, A mu, and B mu Ij, the bosonic gauge fields, and these are Fermi gauge fields. I'm only writing down the independent ones. And these are the additional fields that I had added for n equal to 2. Okay, so I've just written down the number of components. Like here it is 4 into 4, 16. Here it is 4. Here it is 4. Here it is 4 into 3 because this is a SU2 gauge field. So it has 3 components. So it is 4 into 3, 12. Okay, TAB is basically antisymmetric. It's also antisymmetric in IJ. Since I and J runs over 1 and 2, there is only one way it can be anti-symmetrized. So you can forget about IJ. You can just look at AB. So AB is anti-symmetric in 4 dimensions. So 4 into 3 by 2, that is 6. Okay. And D is just a scalar, it's 1. Okay. So if you just count them all, okay. And these are the bosonic symmetries. Okay. You just count this and you count the bosonic symmetry, you subtract them, you'll get 24. Okay. Similarly, this is the Fermionic gauge field. So I is 1 to 2, mu is 4, so 4 into 2, 8, and each of them is a Majorana spinner, so 4 components, so 8 into 4, 32, okay, and here it is 2 into 4, 8, yeah, so there's a doublet of Majorana spinner, so it's 2 into 4, 8, and the symmetries are Q supersymmetry and S supersymmetry, which are 8 and 8 in number, so 8 plus 8, 16, and 40 minus 16 is 24. Okay, so you see that it exactly matches. Okay, but suppose you didn't have these fields. Okay, so if you didn't have chi I and you didn't have TAB, IJ and D, which means that you remove 7 degrees of freedom here and you're removing 8 degrees of freedom here. Okay, so you have basically or to say in alternate other way, you have added 7 bosonic and 8 fermionic to match these degrees of freedom, which means that if you had not added these things, the bosonic and fermionic degrees of freedom would not have matched. Okay. So only because of adding these fields, the bosonic and fermionic degrees of freedom matches. Okay. You can ask the question, how did we know that we have to add this field? Okay, I'm not going into the details, but there is a systematic way to find out what these extra fields that you should add. Okay. So that's a very technical thing. So I'm not going into that, but the fact that we need to add these fields to match the bosonic and fermionic degrees of freedom should be obvious from this counting. Okay. And if you do the similar counting for n equal to 3 and n equal to 4 while multiplied, you will see that with those additional fields you have added, the bosonic and fermionic degrees of freedom matches. Okay. Is it clear?
So earlier we have means 6, 7, and 8. We have to add fermionic and bosonic. 7 bosonic and 8 fermionic, right?
Right.
So my question is, why we want this matching at the first place? And
okay. So for that I need to teach you a little bit of supersymmetry. Okay. For any supersymmetric theory, the bosonic and fermionic degrees of freedom should match. Okay.
So that's a requirement.
That is for any super, otherwise it won't be supersymmetric theory. Okay.
Oh yeah, I understand.
Okay. Okay. Okay, so yeah. Right. So what we have done so far, we started from a superconformal algebra and we wrote down a superconformal gauge theory from there, from that introduced constraints. Okay. And I have added additional fields to complete the multiplate. And what I have not shown you is that we also need to modify the superconformal transformation and the superconformal algebra where the structure constants become structure functions. Okay. Okay, till now we have constructed the while multiplet and the superconformal algebra and how it acts on the while multiplet and how the superconformal algebra closes on the while multiplet. Okay, the last part I didn't show you. I mean, what is the modification to the superconformal algebra? How this structure constants become structure functions? Okay, that is something that I didn't show you because of clarity. Okay. I don't want to clutter things. So I didn't show you because of that. Okay. So now in the next step, just like conformal gravity, you needed to add an additional scalar field to your theory to convert it from conformal gravity to Poincaré gravity. Here you'll also need to introduce additional matter multiplate, which would play the role of the compensating multiplate to go from conformal supergravity to Poincaré supergravity. Okay, so this compensating multiplet will be the supersymmetric analog of that scalar field that we had added in the conformal gravity case. Okay, for n equal to 2, the role of compensating multiplet is played by what is known as the vector multiplet. Okay, so a vector multiplet, n equal to 2 vector multiplet has these components. Okay, there is a vector gauge field, there is a complex scalar, okay, there is a doublet of Majorana spinners, and there is an additional auxiliary field, okay, which is a triplet. Okay. This is n equal to 2 vector multiplet. However, this multiplet alone is not sufficient because of two reasons. Okay. First reason is that we have no field to compensate for the SU2R symmetry. Okay. Okay. So you would be thinking that perhaps we can use this field to gauge fix the SU2R symmetry. But note that this is an auxiliary field. It's not a dynamical field. Okay. So this field would not be helpful for gauge fixing the SU2R symmetry. So that is ruled out. And apart from that, we don't have any field to gauge fix SU2R symmetry. This field is used to gauge fix S supersymmetry. It's a fermionic field. So although it carries an index I, okay, it's a fermionic field and it will be used to gauge fix S supersymmetry. Okay, so we need a bosonic field to gauge fix SU2R symmetry. Okay, and this is an auxiliary field, and the remaining field doesn't have any index I, so it, you cannot get fixed AC to oscillate.
So, sir, PBST for n equal to 4, all those auxiliary fields were not actually auxiliary, right? We have we have dynamical fields also.
Correct.
So, from here, how can we conclude that we don't have any dynamical field? Because is it because n equal to 2?
What do you mean by we don't have any dynamical field? Where?
It's here, in the vector multiplet, you are saying all those are auxiliary fields.
No, 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 no. I'm not said that. I have said that this yij is auxiliary.
Oh, okay.
Okay, because it has mass dimension 2, okay, so it will not have a kinetic term.
Okay, because of mass dimension.
Okay, so it cannot have a kinetic term. Because it doesn't have a kinetic term, it is auxiliary. Okay.
Okay.
So, yeah. So, because of which there we don't have anything to gauge fix your SU2R symmetry. That is one reason. The second reason is that there is a complex scalar which has 2 degrees of freedom, but we actually need 3 scalar degrees of freedom. And the reason is the following. 2 scalar degrees of freedom we will need to compensate for the dilatation and U1K symmetries. Okay, so there are 2 scalar symmetries we have. One is the dilatation and another is U1. Okay, so 2 complex degrees of freedom, 2 real degrees of freedom we will need to compensate for dilatation and U1K symmetry. But we'll also need 1 extra degree of freedom. The reason is this auxiliary, the Y multiplet had a D field, right? You had a D field in the Y multiplet, and that has also mass dimension 2. So it will appear as a Lagrange multiplier in your theory. So what it will do is it will constrain 1 additional scalar degree of freedom. So it's a, since it appears as a Lagrange multiplier, okay, it will constrain 1 additional scalar degree of freedom. Okay, so if it constrains 1 additional scalar degree of freedom, then you have left with only 1 scalar degree of freedom to compensate for 2 scalar symmetries. Okay, which is not possible. Okay, so therefore this multiplet is not sufficient, okay, for these 2 regions. Okay, as a result of which you will need an extra compensating multiplet for n equal to 2. Okay. And there are several choices in n equal to 2. Okay, in n equal to 2, you have something called the tensor multiplet, you have something called the hyper multiplet, you also have something called the nonlinear multiplet. Okay, okay, I'm not going into the details of all these multiplets, but a choice of any of this multiplet as the second compensator to take care of these 2 drawbacks will lead you to different formulation of n equal to 2 supergravity. Okay. Yeah, so this is
the compensator field that you had in your gravity picture that results exactly in which multiplet? I mean, in the n equal to vector or the remaining matter multiplex that you are going to use?
Which compensator in the gravity case, in the conformal gravity case?
Yeah, the 5.
There it was not a multiplet, right? There was no supersymmetry there.
No, the corresponding, the analog of the 5 field.
Analog is, would be the vector multiplet. Okay. Yeah. So analog of that would be the vector multiplet. But here you need an additional multiplet. Why I'm saying the analog of it is the vector multiplet? Because I'll be using the vector multiplet to compensate for the dilatation, right? So I had used the vector multiplet. I had used that scalar field to compensate for the dilatation. I'm still going to use the vector multiplet to compensate for the dilatation. So in that sense, I will call it as an analog of that scalar. Okay. But we need an additional multiplet because of these 2 drawbacks of the vector multiplet. Okay.
Okay.
So that is something we didn't have in the gravity case. Okay. But it is very peculiar for n equal to 2, actually. Actually, it's not even there for n equal to 3 and n equal to 4. This peculiarity is there for only for n equal to 2.
No, the reason I asked actually is this. Basically, generically, to introduce matter content, you would need some matter multiplet, not a vector multiplet, right? Because in the vector multiplet, all these scalars would transform in that joint. So you want something, matter sector, you want...
I have used only 1 vector multiplet. I'm not saying a non-abelian, I'm not introduced a Yang-Mills multiplet here. I've just introduced 1 vector multiplet. Okay.
But here also fields would transform in the joint, right? In all the fields, the AMU, the X, the YIJ, the omega I that you have written, all of them would transform in the adjoint, right?
By adjoint, you mean here it's only U1. It's by adjoint, it means they all transform under U1, right? AMU will go to tell me some. Yeah. So so the E1 only acts on AMU. It doesn't act on X, Y, A, J, or Omega I. They are all inert under the E1 of the multiplier. Okay. Right. So if you had a Yang-Mills multiplier, if you had a I index here, and that I was the Yang-Mills index, this XY would have transformed non-trivially under that Yang-Mills transformation. Okay.
Right.
But it's just a U1 vector multiplier. So A mu will go to del mu lambda, but all the other fields are inert under that U1. Okay, because the structure constant of U1 is 0. Okay. Right. So these are the two compensators that you need for the n=2 supergravity. And in the next step, just like we did for control gravity, we will need to construct invariant actions for the Weyl multiplet as well as the compensating vector multiplet, super conformally invariant actions. In the conformal gravity case, we constructed conformally invariant action for phi as well as the gravity sector fields. Okay, here we would need to construct super conformally invariant actions for the Weyl multiplet as well as the compensating vector multiplet as well as the second multiplet that we need, the tensor multiplet or hyper multiplet, nonlinear multiplet. Okay. And constructing these actions is also a very, very notorious task. For n=2, this is facilitated by something called density formula that had existed in the literature. I mean, it was some work that had been done in the 80s. But this construction of this density formula, since this density formula was there in n=2 conformal supergravity, so these actions were constructed fairly easily. So what is a density formula? A density formula is basically an invariant action which is constructed in terms of some multiplet. Okay. For example, there is a chiral density formula given in this paper from 1980. Okay. Which is in terms of a chiral multiplet. Okay. So there is something called a chiral multiplet in n=2. Okay. And so the property of this chiral multiplet was that the highest component, so this multiplet has components, the highest component of this multiplet transformed into a total derivative. If there was no gravity, the highest component of this multiplet would transform into a total derivative. So just taking that highest component, it's a scalar field, and just taking that highest component into your Lagrangian would mean that it is an invariant Lagrangian, because it transforms to total derivative, so the action will be invariant. Okay. But in the case of gravity, it will transform to a total super covariant derivative. Okay, and the super covariant derivative would have extra terms containing the gravity known everything. Okay, so one just need to add terms involving the gravity known to this highest component to make it invariant. Okay, so yeah, so that is how this chiral density formula was constructed in the 1980s. Similarly, another density formula that was constructed in 1983 was the tensor vector density formula. Okay, this was an invariant action made out of the tensor multiplet and the vector multiplet, combination of tensor multiplet and vector multiplet. Okay, so these density formula were known in the literature, and using this density formula, the actions were constructed. How they were constructed? So basically, what you do is you take the Weyl multiplet fields, okay. And suppose you want to obtain an action for the Weyl multiplet. So you take the Weyl multiplet field and you write down a composite expression for the Weyl multiplet that transforms like a chiral multiplet. Okay. That is what you do. Okay. So you know the transformation of all the fields of the Weyl multiplet. So what you do is you basically take some composite expressions of the Weyl multiplet fields that transforms like a chiral multiplet, okay? And once you know which composite expressions transforms like which component of the chiral multiplet, okay? And you have this chiral density formula where the action is given in terms of the chiral multiplet, you take this composite expression and put it into that formula, you get an action for the Weyl multiplet. Okay? Similarly for the vector multiplet, you take some composite expression of the vector multiplet that transforms like a chiral multiplet, and you basically put it into the chiral density formula and you get an action for the vector multiplet. Okay. That is there. That is how you basically construct the actions for the while multiplier as well as the vector multiplier in n equal to 2. Okay, and once you have that, okay, once you constructed the action for the vector multiplier and the while multiplier, which are super functional invariant, use suitable Poincare gauge fixing conditions, eliminate the auxiliary fields, and you obtain Poincare supergravity. Okay. This is the recipe. It's a long procedure, but this is the recipe. Okay, and all the ingredients of the recipe are there. Okay, you know how to do each of these steps. Okay, and therefore the construction of n equal to 2 supergravity has been very well studied in the literature. Okay. However, this formalism, which works so well for n equal to 2 because of this density formula, does not have a straightforward generalization for n greater than 2, like n equal to 3 or n equal to 4. Okay, and therefore construction of invariant actions for n equal to 3, n equal to 3 while multiplied anyway recently constructed, but n equal to 4 while multiplied was known since the 80s. Okay, but nobody had constructed the action for this n equal to 4 while multiplied. Although n equal to 2 action was constructed immediately after its construction in the 80s, but n equal to 4 while multiplied, even if the multiplied was known in the 80s, the action had not been constructed because the n equal to 2 chiral density formula did not have a straightforward generalization to n equal to 4. Okay, and it had been a challenge. Okay, and in the next section, I'm going to discuss how to develop a principle from which we can construct this density formula. Okay, so the chiral density formula and the tensor vector density formula for n equal to 2 had been some sort of, you know, heat and trial kind of approach. Okay, you had some kind of multiplet whose highest component went to the total derivative, and hence, you know, you could basically write down a density formula in n equal to 2 which was invariant. But suppose that is not there, then what do you do? Okay, what is the principle? There must be some principle from which you can construct this density formula, okay, which could be generalized to n equal to 3 or n equal to 4, or which is generally applicable for all n. Okay, that would help us. Okay, and that is what we are going to discuss in the next section. I can pause for some question if you have.
Sir, I have a different question. If it was not in the literature, this density formula. If it was not in the literature, the density formula.
Could you please ask?
Can it be louder?
Loud. I can't be able to hear your question.
Hello. Can you hear me, sir?
Speak,
hello.
Speak a little bit loud.
Yes.
Yeah, so I'm saying that this density formula and all this were not in the literature, so it will be not. It's notoriously difficult to construct these actions, right?
Right.
How did people figure it out? Means.
As I said, it was purely like maybe it was like a heat. I mean, I don't know, like in the 80s, how people figured it out. What was actually their thought process and all? But what I feel is that it's kind of hit and trials. This chiral multiplet was known, and it was known that the highest component of the chiral multiplet transforms to a total derivative. I mean, it transforms to a total supercovariant derivative if you couple it to gravity, right? But if you switch off gravity, it transforms to a total derivative. Okay, so I can write something here. So the chiral multiplet has several fields. So there is a highest field. Well, like let me call it C. Okay, it transforms to some del mu. Let me call it lambda, where lambda is a Feynman field of that multiplet. Okay. If you switch off all the gravity fields, otherwise it will be not del mu lambda. Sorry, what I'm saying. Some epsilon bar gamma mu del mu lambda. Okay, but it's a total derivative. Okay, so if you take this C d4x, okay, this action would be invariant under this supersymmetry. Right? I mean, there are various other fields in that multiplet, but you don't need to consider any other field of the multiplet. You just take C, it will be invariant. Okay, because under supersymmetry, it transforms to a total derivative. Okay.
Okay.
Yes. So in the absence of gravity, it was very simple that this is invariant action. Okay. What happens in the presence of gravity is that this total derivative becomes a total supercovariant derivative. And because this supercovariant derivative contains additional fields containing the gravity no and all, okay, so you need to add terms containing gravity no to make it invariant. Okay, but you know the starting point, right? You know that C is there. You just need to add terms containing gravity no, and that you could do systematically, because you know the supersymmetry transformation rule. Okay, and so you basically know what additional terms you should add to this action so that it becomes invariant. Okay, right? So that was easier. Okay, but for n equal to 4 and n equal to 3, anyway, it's recent. N equal to 4, it was not like that. We didn't have any such luxury, right? So it was not clear what should be our starting point. Like, even if you want to do some beta trial, it was not clear what should be our starting point. In fact, when we started this n equal to 4 work, we tried a lot of beta trial, and it was I have written a paper where we did construct the action using a beta trial method, and we did manage to construct an action. Okay. But that was very tedious, very tedious. Okay, and then we realized that we can in fact have a very robust action principle based on which we can construct an action. Okay, right, so that is what I'm going to discuss in the next section.
So these SUSY transformations that you have written are basically flat space SUSY transformations. I mean, it doesn't have any curvature coupling. The term proportional to curvature coupling.
Okay, well, in flat space, it will be just del mu. In flat space, it will be epsilon bar gamma mu del mu lambda, something like this.
Right.
When you call it to supergravity, this will be a covariant derivative. And when you have covariant derivative,
No, I'm saying that, for example, when you write two transformations on the sphere, it picks up additional terms that takes into account the fact that the manifold on which you are writing the SUSY transformation is a sphere, not a flat space. So I'm just saying that here, the program that you are following,
okay,
it is basically just
right. Yeah,
here, the background.
Yeah, here it is not like we are writing the SUSY transformation on ADS space or anything. Yeah, in that sense, yes, it is flat space SUSY transformation. I mean, flat space supergravity.
How does this gravity picture enter here? Because inherently you're talking about a picture that has you're talking about a manifold that has a non-trivial curvature, right? So, I'm just trying to understand.
The curvature is there, but the curvature is not entering into the transformations here. It does enter the transformation. I mean, it's not like it doesn't enter the transformation, but it's not like, Yes. Yeah. I mean, it does enter the transformation, but it's not like, how do I say? I mean, if you're thinking of this RM and RM curvature and all, they enter the transformation of some fields.
Okay.
But it is not like it enters in a non-trivial way. I mean, it's very difficult for me to say how it enters. But I'm not talking about any background space time curvature here. I'm talking about
that's curvature. That's right. That was my question. Yeah, because basically, for example, on the sphere, if you are writing transformations on a sphere, on the background sphere. Mm-hmm. You would have terms which drop out basically when you take the radius to infinity, which reduces to your flat space of the transformations.
So I don't have any background space curvature here. Yeah.
Okay.
But okay. It's still super gravity. I'm writing down a theory of super gravity. Right. So you can think of
these via this probably via spherical coupling, right? I mean, we're just transforming your the Gaussian derivative, etc. So this is some kind of a minimal coupling procedure, perhaps.
Sorry.
So this is via probably some minimal coupling procedure where you're just eliminating your covariant derivative to include the spin connections.
Yes. Yeah. I mean.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, here we don't have any background curvature or anything. Yeah. So it's here you have a gravity multiplet in terms of which you are writing down the theory. Right, the gravity multiplet right. contains graviton and gravitino and so on. Yeah.
Right. So those things have their individual variations, of course.
Yes.
Okay.
So, yeah. So let us discuss about this action principle. Okay. And this will allow us to systematically construct density formula in general. And it will allow us to go beyond this chiral density formula and the tensor vector density formula or the linear vector density formula that I had talked about earlier. Okay, and this action principle, basically the idea is very simple. It follows from a very simple observation in differential geometry. Okay, so let us consider this d-dimensional manifold, a capital D-dimensional manifold, and a smaller closed small d-dimensional sub-manifold M. Okay. And let us consider an integral of a D form on this sub-manifold. Okay. Yeah, so this is what I have considered. This J is a D form, and I am considering this integral on the sub-manifold M. Okay. And under arbitrary diffeomorphism in the larger manifold, in the entire manifold, this D form J transforms as a Lie derivative, which you know, okay, that you can write a Lie derivative can be written as a anti-commutator of exterior derivative and interior product. Okay, so the under an arbitrary diffeomorphism, this D form would go into this particular thing, D of I xi j plus I xi dj. Okay, of course, this is a total derivative piece. Okay, so I'm considering arbitrary diffeomorphism in the full manifold, okay, not just in the sub-manifold. Of course, writing in this way means that this is invariant under arbitrary diffeomorphism in the sub-manifold. But I want to consider an arbitrary diffeomorphism in the full manifold and see if this is invariant under arbitrary diffeomorphism of the full manifold. Okay, so this is a total derivative piece which will drop out. Either if you take the submanifold to be a closed submanifold, in which case it doesn't have any boundary, or even if you don't take it to be a closed submanifold, even if it has boundary, you can take appropriate fall off conditions as a result of which this total derivative will drop out. Which means that under arbitrary diffeomorphism, this action will be invariant, okay, if this D from J is closed, if DJ is equal to zero, okay? So this action integral will be invariant under arbitrary diffeomorphism is if dj is equal to zero. Okay. So that is a purely differential geometric result. Okay. Now you can think of the following case where this submanifold M is your space-time manifold, and this larger manifold is the manifold where you have geometrized some gauge symmetries. Okay. So which means that this arbitrary diffeomorphism in the larger manifold can be broken up into arbitrary diffeomorphism of the submanifold and arbitrary diffeomorphism away from the submanifold, which will be like a gauge symmetry. Okay, so if you have geometrized your gauge symmetry, an arbitrary diffeomorphism of the larger manifold is basically a combination of diffeomorphism on N and gauge symmetry. Okay, so in that case, an invariant action integral, which is invariant under diffeomorphism of M as well as gauge symmetry, is basically writing down a D form J, small d form J, which is closed. Okay, which is closed in the full larger manifold. Okay, then it will be invariant under diffeomorphism as well as gauge symmetry. Okay, so let us first see this through a bosonic example. Okay, before going to supergravity, I will demonstrate this thing with a simple bosonic example, which is the D equal to 3 John-Simons action, okay, which is basically this. Okay, so this is a three form. Okay. So you take a gauge field A, it's a non-abelian gauge field, okay, which is a one form, okay, and you construct this three form. And we know that the integral of this three form in three dimension is invariant under gauge symmetry, okay, up to total derivatives. Okay, now we will see that this basically the invariance of this this thing under gauge symmetry actually falls nicely into this discussion. Okay, so let's see. Okay, so if you look at the gauge transmission of this non-abelian gauge field, if you write it in for the form notation, it is this. Okay. Now let us geometrize the gauge symmetries as we had discussed earlier and promote the gauge field as a part of the super Weilbein of the larger manifold. Okay. So think of the gauge field. Okay. So you have now geometrized the gauge symmetries. Okay. And in that larger manifold, your super Weilbein is basically a combination of this Weilbein and the gauge field. Okay. So you have also introduced additional coordinates because you have geometrized the gauge symmetry. So x mu are the space-time coordinates and phi alpha are the additional coordinates where you have geometrized the gauge symmetry. Okay. So all of these fields, all of these one forms, EA as well as AI, not only has legs in the space-time direction, but it also has legs in the additional direction, right? So it's not in the larger manifold, it's not really the space-time Weilbein or the space-time gauge field. Only if you truncate it to the space-time, only if you remove this part, then only this part is only the gauge, this part of EA is a Weilbein and this part of AI is a gauge field, okay? Otherwise it has legs along the additional direction also. Okay.
Sir, can you explain this part, DZMEMA?
So I have introduced additional coordinates. So ZM are my coordinates. ZMs are my coordinates. So these are my X mu and phi alpha. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So for example, EA will be written as DX mu E mu A plus D phi alpha E alpha A. Okay. This part is my standard Weilbein, and this part is an additional thing which is there in the larger manifold. Okay, so when I will be loosely calling this as Weilbein one form, but you should keep in mind that it is not just the Weilbein one form in the larger manifold, but it also has some additional piece. Okay, but I will still loosely call this as Weilbein one form. Okay. Okay, and you will see that we can define this interior product on this Weilbein one form and the gauge field one form as the following. Okay, I will tell you why I choose this interior product in this way.
So here A runs from what does A run from the basically the tangent space index? I mean, does it run from over the whole number of dimensions, right? The bigger manifold.
Where this A, capital A?
No, the small A. So the tangent space index.
The small A is still the tangent space index. So A still runs from 1, 2, 3, right? Because E mu A in E mu A still runs from 1, 2, 3, right? Yeah, so EA, we had earlier only E mu A, now we have extended the manifold to this capital M. Okay, the number of Weilbeins has increased, but that has increased by this many numbers. Okay, EA.
My confusion was on the larger manifold, the tangent space, I mean the number of basis vectors of the tangent space would be more, right? On the bigger manifold.
Yes. That is why you have this capital A, right? Capital A, basically small a and capital I. So it is larger.
Okay. Right. Okay. Thanks.
Right. Okay. So now we had in the space-time manifold, we had this definition of the field strength, right? The field strength is given in terms of exterior derivative and the wedge product of A in this way, okay? And that we can use to define an exterior derivative for this AI, okay? Although this is basically true for the true on the space-time manifold, because this field strength is defined in this particular way on the space-time manifold, but we extend this definition to the full manifold, okay? So now when I have written this here, you should think of this AI as the entire one form, not just this part, the full one form, okay? And so all these expressions that are appearing here are the full one form, including the including in the additional direction, okay? So this defines my exterior derivative of AI, okay? So if I truncate this expression to the space-time manifold, I get my standard definition of field strength, okay? But this is the definition of exterior derivative on AI, take it to be true for the entire larger manifold.
Sir, can you explain again why should we consider this exterior derivative for the whole manifold?
Because that is my natural choice. Because this, if exterior derivative I take and I truncate it to the space-time manifold, I get my field strength, which is true for the space-time manifold.
Oh, so this is okay. A generalized
generalized exterior derivative. Okay.
So if you truncate this to space-time, you get F.
Yes. Yeah. Right. And now with the above definition of the exterior derivative, you can see that the interior product that I had defined also becomes consistent, because in that case, you can see that that the gauge transformation that I had written for AI, okay, can be written as a combination of interior product and exterior derivative in this particular case, which you also want to be true. Okay. So our generalization of the interior product and exterior derivative to the larger manifold is basically consistent, because this is satisfied. Okay. Now, if you take the exterior derivative on AI that I had defined earlier, and you calculate DJ, okay, because J was constructed in terms of AIs, okay, you know what is DAI, okay, it's very straightforward to calculate DJ. You will get it to be equal to this, okay, trace F wedge F, okay, where F wedge F, you can write it to be this. Now, this is zero, not because it is a four form, because a four form is not necessarily zero in the larger manifold, right? The space-time manifold is three-dimensional, but the larger manifold is larger, right? So in that manifold, the four form need not be zero identically. But this is zero because it is anti-symmetric in A, B, C, and D, whereas A, B, C, and D takes only three values.
Why is space-time manifold three-dimensional?
We have taken that, right? Our Chan-Simons gauge theory was defined on a
three-dimensional. Oh, okay. They equal to three. Sorry. How about
J was a three form, right? Okay. So this is zero because this four form is basically a wedge product of all the EAs only. There is no AI appearing here. And because it's a wedge product of EAs, okay, it's anti-symmetric in A, B, C, and D. Okay. But A, B, C, and D takes only three values. So anything which is anti-symmetric in A, B, C, and D, which takes three values, must be zero, right? Okay. So this is the reason why the action integral constructed out of J is gauge invariant. Okay. If you would have taken any other coefficient there, okay, instead of 2/3, if you would have taken any other coefficient here and you calculate DJ, okay, you will get some four forms, which will be combination of EA, EB, EC, and some AI, or EA, EB, AI, AJ, right? Then in that case, it won't be zero. You understand what I'm saying? Okay. Only for this coefficient 2/3, if you choose, DJ becomes proportional to EA wedge, EB wedge, EC wedge, ED, as a result of which it is anti-symmetric in A, B, C, and D, and therefore it is zero.
So actually you want to make DJ equal to zero, right? So that's why you are
constructing
like this.
Okay. So if you want to back calculate it, if you did not know what a Chan-Simons action is, okay, right? If you did not know what a Chan-Simons action is, and you want to you want to write down some gauge invariant action like this. So you put some arbitrary index alpha here, okay, and you ensure you try to ensure dj equal to zero. You will get that our alpha has to be 2/3. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Right. So this is So this from this bosonic example, your this formalism should be clear. Now I go to supergravity. Okay. Now we'll apply this principle to the supersymmetric case. Okay. So you basically geometrize supersymmetry by going to the superspace. Okay. Just like we did it for the gauge theory. Okay, you have to take a super Galbine where you have to take the gravity of one forms as additional super part of the super Galbine. Okay, and the supersymmetric invariance of this action would be guaranteed if J is closed in the full superspace. Okay. However, we'll be interested in Kaufman supergravity, so this is a technical point. Okay, in Kaufman supergravity. Apart from diffeomorphism and local supersymmetry, we have a bunch of other gauge symmetries also, right? Local Lorentz transformation dilatation, U1 R symmetry, SU2 or SU4 R symmetry, okay? Special conformal transformation and S supersymmetry. Okay, so these additional gauge symmetries are also there apart from local supersymmetry. Okay, in this way, we will make this invariant under local supersymmetry, but we also want invariants under these additional gauge symmetries. Okay. However, these gauge symmetries, if you look at their how they act on the fields, it's not very complicated. So implementing these gauge symmetries is not very difficult. So it can be directly implemented. So we will not geometrize these gauge symmetries. We will rather demand that this and this four form, if we are doing four dimension, this four form should be invariant under these additional gauge symmetries. Okay, so we will not geometrize it. We can directly make this J form invariant under these additional gauge symmetries. Okay. Okay, and because of which we can replace the closure condition on J to a covariant closure condition. Okay, remember that we had our demand should have been dj equal to zero, but that dj equal to zero I can replace it with a nabla j equal to zero. Where nabla is basically a covariant exterior derivative. Okay, it's exterior derivative plus additional covariantization with respect to all other gauge symmetries except supersymmetry, except the ordinary supersymmetry. Okay, there is a S supersymmetry also with respect to which we should covariantize this. Okay. Doing this basically makes the calculation very systematic, and we can systematically construct everything. That is the technical point to do this. Okay. Okay. So now we will be restricting ourselves to four dimension and writing this four form as a wedge product of the super Galbines, okay, contracted with some super covariant object. Okay. So this object is fully super covariant, and these are my super Galbine one forms, and there is a wedge product implicit between them. Just to avoid cluttering, I have not explicitly written down the wedge products here. Okay. Now, in order to implement nabla j equal to zero, okay, we need to know how nabla acts on a super covariant object and how nabla acts on the super Galbine one forms. Okay, and that you can get it directly from the it's well known, because if you know how the Weyl multiplet transforms, you basically know how this covariant exterior derivative will act on the super Galbine one forms. So this is how it acts on the Galbine one form. This is how it acts on the gravity no one forms. Okay. No need to go into all the details here, but just I'm telling you that we know how this covariant exterior derivatives acts on the super Galbine one forms and on any super covariant object. Okay. So once you know that, okay, you need to start with some answers. Okay, you need to specify the structure of the four form in J containing the maximum number of gravity node. Okay, so it's a four form, right? So it can contain maximum four gravity node. Sometimes it can contain less than that also. We'll look into one such case, but maximum it can contain four gravity node. Okay, Okay, so you need to specify an ansatz for J containing the maximum number of gravity node. And then when you impose nabla J equal to zero, okay, you will get some constraint on this highest gravity node block, and it will give you further blocks containing lesser number of gravity node, which would be basically related to the highest gravity node block by supersymmetry. Okay, it's a very long procedure. I'm just outlining the process. Okay, so that's what will happen. Okay, so basically what will so in short, what will happen is,
one moment. Something went wrong. Please try again.
Okay, sorry about that. This CV of my iPad became crazy. Okay, so yeah, so in short, the starting answer, so what you give as an answer for the highest gravity node block will tell you what the density formula is, and it will tell you what is the abstract multiplet in terms of which you have obtained the density formula. Okay. So everything is encoded in what you choose as your answers for the highest gravity node block. That is the upshot of this. Okay. For example, if I start with the highest gravity node block like this in n equal to 2 supergravity, okay, so these are my gravity node one forms written in Dirac notation. Okay, so these are all Dirac notations. Okay, so this is the bilinear, this is the bilinear. And since it is n equal to 2, I can contract them with a two-dimensional Levi-Civita. Okay, and this is a scalar, this is a complex scalar. Okay, and imposing this condition, okay, basically gives me a density formula, which is nothing but the chiral density formula. Okay. So earlier we said that chiral density formula was obtained as some kind of hit and trial. Okay, we see that there is actually a systematic way to obtain this chiral density formula using this action principle. Okay. So you will find that this compose, this thing A that was your answers for the starting point, okay, it transforms as a imposing this condition. You will see that this will transform like the lowest component of a chiral multiplet, and everything else in the density formula that you will obtain, which will be related to A by supersymmetry, would basically be related to it in the same way as the components of a chiral multiplet would be related to the lowest component of a chiral multiplet. Okay, so that is what you will obtain, right? So okay, so this is the upshot of this. So depending on what is your starting point, you can obtain the density formula as well as the abstract multiplet in terms of which you have obtained the density formula. Okay. So now this means that we can do our work with n equal to 4. Okay. Okay, so we have the tool in hand. Okay, we can basically now apply to n equal to 4, which we did in this couple of papers. Okay, we constructed a new density formula for n equal to 4, and subsequently the most general invariant action for the n equal to 4 while multiplied. Okay, for that we need to know how the covariant extended derivatives acts on the super VL by one form, so which is given in these first three lines, and on any super covariant object, right? Once we know this, how this exterior derivative acts on these things, the next point is we need to start with an ansatz for the highest gravity node block. And this is what we chose as an ansatz, okay. So unlike n equal to 2, we could not start with an ansatz where this was a scalar field, okay. But we can start with an ansatz where these objects are not scalars. But they transform, these are Lorentz scalars, okay, but under SU4 they have some non-trivial representation. Okay, so the C, C bar and A, they transform in the 20 prime irreducible representation of SU4. It basically means 20 prime basically means that these are anti-symmetric in the upper two and the lower two indices, and traceless between any pair of upper and lower index, that is the 20 prime representation of SU4. Okay, and imposing nabla j is equal to zero gives us a set of constraints on this C, C bar and A, and a complete density formula, which means that the other blocks, which contains three gravity node, two gravity node, one gravity node, and so on, and the component of those blocks are related to these objects via supersymmetry. So in that sense, we get the complete density formula. Okay. And in order to obtain the action for n equal to 4 while multiplied, you need to write down some combination of the while multiplied fields, okay, which would basically fit into the C, C bar A, and subsequently the other components of the density formula would be related to them by a supersymmetry transformation. Okay, so you basically write down combination of while multiplied fields which can fit into C, C bar and A, okay, which means that they have to satisfy this set of constraints. Okay, you basically means you need to satisfy the constraint equations. Okay, ultimately you find that everything would be given in terms of an arbitrary holomorphic function of this SC11 scalar. So we obtain an action which is given in terms of this, so arbitrary holomorphic function of this SC11 scalars. Okay, and yeah, so it's a very long action. Yeah.
Interrupting. Yes. So RC and C bar related in some way? I mean, the reason you are using the same letter is the reason you are using the same letter?
Which thing? I didn't get your question.
C and C bar, are they related? Like by some direct communication?
Yes. So if you demand reality of the action, yeah, they will be related by a Hermitian conjugation. Yes.
Because, okay.
Yeah, they are the Hermitian conjugates.
This C is just real and do away with the second term?
No. Yeah, that is also one point, because this C and C bar would be basically, you know, mixing with each other as they move on. Whereas in n equal to 2, that was not the case. So if you look at my n equal to 2, this thing. No, this was it. Yeah, so in n equal to 2, I just started with this, right? I did not introduce a Hermitian conjugate here. Okay, right. So which gave me the chiral density formula. The Hermitian conjugate will give me the anti-chiral density formula. So it will give me, so in n equal to 2, somehow it happens that the chiral multiplet and the anti-chiral multiplet basically decouple from each other. But that is not true in general. Okay. Yeah, so even if I would have started from this plus Hermitian conjugate, the A and A bar would not have talked with each other at all. They would never talk with each other. Okay. The part.
But they are some of the mixed.
Yeah. Here, in n equal to 4, they will be mixed. Yeah. They will be, you know, non-trivially mixed as we go on. Yeah. So we cannot really decouple this. And we cannot really remove this and work with C. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
So, Vindushar, you have finished your 2 hours. It's going beyond. So, try to wrap up things.
Okay. I will wrap up. Yes. So this is So these are the results. And So I'll just quickly say that using the similar recipe, we also constructed the n equal to 3 action, which was a recent one we put up in archive with my student Madhu and former student Subramania. Okay, so we found a density formula for n equal to 3 by starting with a highest gravity no answer, similar to what we had for n equal to 4. And we obtained, imposing this condition, we obtained the complete density formula and finally the invariant action. Okay, another thing that I wanted to tell you that is not only useful for n greater than 2, that is finding action for n equal to 3 and n equal to 4, it can also be used in finding new density formula for n equal to 2 and hence newer action for n equal to 2. For example, in this work with my former student Subramania, we modified the starting point of the density formula for n equal to 2. So here we don't have a 4 gravity node block. We have a 3 gravity node block as the highest gravity node block. Okay? So basically our highest gravity node block, instead of being a 4 gravity node block, is a 3 gravity node block. Which means that this thing that is appearing here is a fermionic component instead of a bosonic component. So we get it, and we work this out, so we get a density formula, which is basically in terms of a fermionic multiplet instead of being on a, in terms of a bosonic multiplet, like the chiral multiplet, it is in terms of a fermionic multiplet. Okay, and we obtained the full density formula and we used it to construct action for some known multiplets. For example, we had this multiplet, a real scalar multiplet that we had found with Subramanian Ibano in 2018. We used this density formula to construct an action for that. Okay, and basically we also used the relation between this real scalar multiplet and the tensor multiplet to find a new higher derivative action for the n equal to 2 tensor multiplet. Okay, so you see that this formalism also gave us a way to go beyond the known results in n equal to 2 and finding newer results in n equal to 2. Okay, so that's all that I wanted to say. I will just finish with some of the future directions that we are thinking about in the context of the talk. Of course, there are a lot of other problems that we are also thinking about, but in the context of the talk, what we are thinking about to do in the future is now we have an action for n equal to 4 while multiplet. Earlier, Deru had already constructed an action for n equal to 4 vector multiplet. Okay, so now we have the ingredient to construct n equal to 4 Poincare supergravity, right? So we have, so in n equal to 4 supergravity, the vector multiplets act as compensators, but only one vector multiplet is not enough. You need at least 6 vector multiplets. Okay, so we can obtain n equal to 4 Poincare supergravity by combining the action for n equal to 4 while multiplet, which I showed you how we constructed, and combine that with the action for at least 6 vector multiplets with the wrong sign of the kinetic term. Okay. Then gauge fix the additional symmetries and remove the auxiliary fields by their equations of motion.
इतने clever mathematical tricks लगा के ये लोग complicate करते हैं और जैसे complicate किया है पूरा उससे वापस ले आते हैं और बोलते हैं कि complicate करके इतने easy होगा calculation वो फिर से वापस वो condition reduce कर देते हैं complicacy से.
Exactly. Hello. This is मैंने सीखा. इसे नहीं.
Hello, Abhinav.
Yeah, I'm sorry, sir. It's became unmuted.
Okay. So yeah, we can add more vector multiplets. So basically, in this way, we can obtain n equal to 4 Poincare supergravity. So this is something that we are working on now. Okay. And in this way, we'll obtain pure n equal to 4 Poincare supergravity. Okay, we can add additional vector multiplets with the right sign of the kinetic term in those, and those vector multiplets will be the physical vector multiplet, which will be coupled to n equal to 4 Poincare supergravity. Okay, right? And then there are some results in the literature with which we would like to connect our work. So in 2 derivative n equal to 4 Poincare supergravity, there is some anomaly for a particular E1 subgroup of the electromagnetic duality group SU1,1. Okay, and in the literature also it has been found there are some characteristic counter terms higher order in derivatives which can cancel this anomaly, and for a particular choice of this holomorphic function that characterizes our n equal to 4 while multiplet action, this work will give us a fully super covariant super symmetric counter term that would cancel this anomaly. Okay, so that would be interesting. And this counter term, basically which is higher order in derivative, would remove the E1 anomaly, but it will break the SU1,1 electromagnetic duality. Okay. So now we would also want to understand, can it does it break it completely, or does it preserve some discrete subgroup of that, like SL2Z? Okay. And we are also looking into understanding the implications of this on the entropy of n equal to 4 supersymmetric black holes. Okay, earlier the supergravity aspect of these n equal to 4 black holes were studied in the n equal to 2 truncated setting because there was no off-shell formulation of n equal to 4 supergravity available in the literature. But now with our work, we might try to connect it by directly looking at these supersymmetric black holes in the n equal to 4 setting. Okay, and then for n equal to 3 also, we would like to find the action for n equal to 3 vector multiplet coupled to conformal supergravity. And then basically obtain the n equal to 3 Poincare supergravity by combining the n equal to 3 while multiplet action, which you have already obtained, with the action for at least 3 vector multiplets, which will play the role of compensators and gauge fixing and eliminating the auxiliary fields, as I had told. And we can also add more vector multiplets, which will carry physical degrees of freedom. And then we will also like to look at n equal to 3 gauge supergravity and use it for studying n equal to 3 superconformal field theory using ADS-CFT correspondence. And there has been some interest in the literature with n equal to 3 superconformal field theory using ADS-CFT correspondence. And this is where we can try to fit in. Okay, so yeah, so I think I have taken a lot of time. With this, I would like to end. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you for your contribution, Bindu sir.
Thank you, sir.
So I will only allow one question.
I mean, the corresponding has been extended or the anti-material, I mean, it has been exists in the literature for the both the cases, the lambda positive and the lambda negative cases also. I'm just asking.
Yeah, classically, I think gauge supergravity will give you only lambda negative. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know how to get lambda positive from there. Yeah.
Okay.
I will not allow not a single question right now because you guys have asked too many questions to Bindu sir. If you have any question, write to him and ask him because this is already going towards 2.5 hours. I will not continue more than that. And thank you, Bindu sir, for your contribution. And once this talk will be uploaded in YouTube, and I will share the link with you. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay.
So,
okay. Thank you.
I would suggest all the attendees, please unmute yourself and give a clap for him for giving such a nice elaborative talk. So please unmute yourself and give it. So stay safe and healthy. We will get in touch with you and I will share the link with you once this is uploaded. Okay.
Okay. Bye. Okay, bye.
Bye.